respectful to everyone's time, let's go ahead and get started, and appreciate you coming out tonight and hearing our second of eight presentations that we have scheduled in our community. My name is Jeff Nelson, and I am the new superintendent here in the Grafton School District, and we appreciate you coming out to become more informed about our referendum project that's coming up for the vote. It's coming up on April 4th. So we have a number of board members that are here, as well as our business manager, and we're going to try and walk through the slides and then give some time for questions that you might have throughout the whole time. So I'm going to turn it over to Mark Kaler, one of our board members, that will start us off tonight.
Okay. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you for coming out tonight. So yeah, the plan of attack for tonight, we're going to go through, I'll talk about the needs of the district, and who's coming up next. Dan's going to come up, talk about, Dan McKelvey will come up, talk about the process that was used to evaluate those needs of the district, and then Jeff Nelson will come back up and talk about the solution that came out of that process. So, looking at the Grafton School District, you know, we have a very good district, very good staff, but we do have some facility needs within our district. Back in November, at the election, there were $880 million worth of referendums passed back in November. So we're not alone. Other districts have facility needs, so do we. So that's one of the things we started looking at back after the referendum failed in April. We initially started by looking at GS. Those of you familiar, it's attached to the high school. There are some obvious facility needs, structural needs there. That school is actually sitting below, about 2 feet down from where it should be. It's kind of settling in the ground. The rains, we have water in the basement. We have some flooding down there. One of the things we need to be worried about is mold. We don't have mold in that facility. Jamie Schofield here is on top of that. We're testing for it. But it's one of those things we need to be aware of. So along with that mold and other structural issues, that facility needs some needs to be addressed. So we also looked, soon after I got on the board, we contracted with Sigma Group and had them come in, look at that facility and evaluate it, and what would it take to get that facility structurally sound for another 20 or 30 years. That number came in about $14 million. Well, and we said, what do we compare it to? So we compared it to replacing that facility with the same capacity student-wise, essentially the same type of school, and that cost was 13 some million. So it was, there wasn't a lot of difference. So we had that information, and that'll feed into the kind of the process we went through. Then we also looked at the high school and what are the needs up there. The science facilities is one of those needs. The science facilities haven't been touched in 45 years. We got some good programs, a program called Project Lead the Way. Started in 2013, enrollment interest is growing. A lot of students getting involved in that type of program, possibly going into the medical field. Well, we really don't have the facilities to meet the needs of that program. So that's one of the areas. We also have a great tech ed program. We just heard about the autos program going on to nationals. We've got wood, we've got metal shops. Those areas are stretched for space. I think we got some good things. I know we have some good things going with Project Lead the Way, with our autos program, for example, but they're kind of dealing with the facilities as they are. It poses a challenge, I would say, for both teachers and for students to learn effectively. So those were some of the glaring needs of the district. We also looked at all the facilities in the district and what needs to be done there. And accessibility, ADA type, accessibility needs to be addressed. Also safety. If you came in here tonight, this is probably one of the better schools in terms of safety. When you enter the school, you actually have to go in the office to get in to the school. Not all of our schools are set up that way. Obviously, there's been a lot of issues with schools in the news over the years. We need to protect our students and our teachers. So that's one of the other needs that needs to be addressed. Lastly, traffic. Those with students would know at John Long here, at Woodview, at Kennedy, those are some of the glaring problems with traffic flow with both buses and parents trying to get in and out of those facilities. So we wanted to address that through this process. And we just recently contracted with Kapoor and Associates, who has conducted a traffic study of all of our facilities. And they will be making some recommendations to us within a month, which we will take those into account with the final product. Now, what we have put together, Jody will probably talk about it, really financially covers it. We've gone with some design, but whatever they come back with, they've looked at what we initially came up with or what Hoffman came up with, and they said, you know what, if it needs to be tweaked, you've got the money and the budget to do it. So it'll be just tweaks to what's there, nothing that would be cost prohibitive. So those were kind of the glaring needs that we identified, and then Dan will talk about the process, really, the community went through to evaluate those needs.
Good evening. I apologize. I'm going to have to read most of mine. I got my script about 20 minutes ago, so I don't miss anything here. I'm going to have to probably read, so I apologize for that. So, the process, we really had two priorities when we started looking at this. First, certainly, was the academic needs of the students. But secondly, and almost as important, certainly, is the fiscal responsibility to all the district taxpayers, of course, too. And with that in mind, as you know, over the last several years, the board has worked to engage community members in the needs of the district, the needs evaluation process, and ultimately the solution was placed in the file. The process itself has actually been going on now for about 5 years, starting with a comprehensive facilities-wide assessment that was done in 2012. And then over the past 4 years, we've actually spent about $3.5 million on what we saw as probably the highest priority maintenance needs in the district. We've had two committees over time here. There was an initial committee back with the first referendum. And after that one failed, we actually created another, what we call the Facilities Advisory Committee, which amounted to 30-some, 40 people, I believe was the number, many of which were people from the public that applied to be on it. There were staff members, there were two board members that were on there. I was at most of them. I wasn't officially part of the committee, but I was in the audience, kind of a silent observer for most of them. They spent over 25 hours, actually, on this process at all their various meetings, at different schools, touring the schools behind the scenes and seeing everything, where all the needs were. They originally started with 9 options, where then they narrowed it down to the options on your screen. Next.
Yep, so when we narrowed up 9 to 1, the option that has been referred is to eliminate one of the schools. So Grafton Elementary School, you heard the cost that it would take to replace it, repair it, whatever it would be, and that cost was and that wouldn't touch any of the other schools in our district. So as the committee moved forward, we looked at Grafton Elementary School being closed, which would result in Grafton Elementary students then being transferred to Woodview and Kennedy. So right now we have 3 elementary schools, and depending on the content area or the grade level you teach at, we have the haves and have-nots. There's certain grade levels that have quite big classrooms. There's certain content areas that have a bigger, let's say it's a music room, or let's say it's an IMC, as a gym, with you and Kennedy both use their cafeteria as their gym. And the goal was to say, how can we have a district whereby no matter which school students go to, they're going to receive the similar type of opportunities and the similar type of benefits of being in that. So that's where we look at students that would be at GES would be transferred to either Kennedy or with you, and those things would be renovated to support those incoming students. Jody is our representative from Hoffman. He's going to walk us through the plans. We should have a handout, and it's going to be hard to see, and that's why we have the big things in the back. But he'll walk us through what each of these schools looks like and sort of the highlights for each school that's being touched upon.
So we're going to start out with Grafton High School. Before I do that, I'll just introduce myself. Jody Andrews, I'm working with Hoffman. We were, as I mentioned, we were hired a while ago start with the kind of the purplish color there. Remodeling of the existing locker rooms. As with many facilities here at the high school or at the high school, these spaces are original to the 1971 construction of the building. So as part of this project, all the locker rooms, basically the whole envelope extending out to the commons area there a little bit, that is going to be completely gutted and renovated as part of it. So all the interior partitions, fixtures, all the lockers, those will all be taken out and completely reconfigured and replaced as part of this project. The next one down is the red area, the remodeling of the kitchen. Currently, all the meals for the school district are prepared at Grafton Elementary School. And frankly, they're prepared in quite a small, undersized, overutilized kitchen. Part of this project, obviously, is taking down Grafton Elementary School. So the decision was made to put the new production kitchen for the entire district here at the high school. So the kitchen gets expanded in its current footprint. Additional serving area kind of going out into the common space will be remodeled. Along with that, you see the more solid areas on the plan. Because we're taking up some of the commons area for kitchen space, we're going to be making a small addition for additional common space out towards the courtyard, towards the parking lot. This is towards the water tower on the side. In addition to that, on the other side of the building, because we're going to have lots of ingredients and food and things coming into the building, and also prepared meals going out of the building, the receiving area is being expanded out by the facility. That's really to accommodate those deliveries and drop-offs, but also one of the areas that's really undersized in that building is for supply storage and for maintenance. So that's being expanded out to the west side. Moving down into the green area,
One of the measures that the board decided to do was go from the 250 seats. Games and competition happening here with spectators. It's a little bit smaller than maybe like a high school performance gym, but still houses a full-size court in here. And along with that, we are increasing the number of toilets in this facility. If you've ever been in here, you realize that there's only these toilets serving the whole building right now. So both floors get additional toilets, computer labs, office spaces along. And then lastly, what's currently the gym will remain there as a cafeteria, and we're allowing some additional space there for kitchen expansion. So this is just a serving kitchen, but even as just at the capacity of a serving kitchen, it's very undersized. So we're expanding that back into the service area back here. Additionally, as was mentioned, this John Long is actually the only school that has a secure entry. None of your three other schools have that. I didn't mention that on the high school, but that is included in the high school, is creating a secure entry for that building. And we're doing the same thing here as well as Woodview. So there's going to be some office reconfiguration and the reconfiguration of that main entry to allow all the doors to be locked down during the day. If you want to come into this facility, you either have to have a key card, which is issued by the district, or you have to come in, check into the office before you can get into the rest of the facility. In addition to that, as with all these facilities, including the high school and Woodview, there's extensive infrastructure remodeling that's happening along with this. So things like replacing of HVAC equipment and lights, those kind of things are included within this too. And if you look at the diagrams and read these little boxes here, you can get a better idea of all the things that are happening as part of this project. One of the challenges, as Mark pointed out, with really all of these sites is vehicle and bus and pedestrian circulation around the site. So at every site, including Kennedy here, we're addressing that in a couple of different ways. And again, this has gone through with the village, so they've had some good thoughts and good input on this. Basically, along 11th Avenue, we're creating some pullout space, not only as an additional lane for drop-off, but also some parking spaces out in front of here that gets it out of the traffic flow of that street. Additionally, we're creating from Maple Street all the way up to Broad Street a through-site circulation that, in this case, it's labeled for bus drop-off. But this is one of those things that, as the district looks at the traffic study, it might make sense that this becomes parent drop-off and this becomes bus drop-off. The idea here, and Kapoor has confirmed that, is there's enough flexibility in the budgets and the design that those kind of flip-flops can happen after the referendum passes and after the traffic study is completed. So, we call it this right now as a bus drop-off and parent drop-off. That might be flip-flop when this whole thing is done. But the main point is that parent drop-off and bus drop-off will be separated on this site as much as we possibly can in this case. Obviously, we're adding additional staff, additional students to the facility, so we have to add additional parking, so that's being expanded. And then we're going to be relocating some of the paved play area and the playground space here too. At Woodview Elementary, again, similar situation to Kennedy. This needs to be expanded to house that extra section of students at all grades. So again, you're looking at the same size gymnasium addition. This is actually off to the west side here. Kitchen is expanding. There's some bathrooms being expanded in here, and then another kindergarten room is going to be required at this facility. So there's a small addition for that out here. You see the majority of the classroom additions will happen out here to the east side of the building. With all these additions, including this one, these are all going to be designed so if they need to be expanded in the future, you can easily do that. So you see quarters that can be continued out here. You can add on more classrooms. But we want to make sure that we allow that to happen pretty easily. So also you see the new secure entry here. Some of the same features that we talked about in terms of improving the infrastructure. One of the other major areas of work is right here where your current special needs areas are. Those were temporary walls that were put in place. Those are basically being taken out and put in, being replaced with permanent structures, as well as creating some early childhood and 4K spaces out of three or four existing classrooms there. Now, if you were really sharp and you noticed, when we talk about Woodview, we have the EC 4K through 5. When you look at Kennedy, you'll just see 4K through 5. So at one point, as we went through this process, there was an early childhood classroom at both facilities. As it currently stands, early childhood will only be happening at Woodview. You currently only have one classroom right now at GES. That one, you're not going to change that, so you're going to go to that one that's just remain as one classroom here. If you look at some of the renderings in back two, and they're not in the presentation, but you'll see there are actually opportunities for us to bring things like daylight into these interior classrooms. We're going to do that as much as we possibly can. Yes, we're going to be covering up some outside windows here, but we can use borrowed lights and clear stories to bring in some natural daylight into these interior classrooms too. So that's actually shown on some of the images in the back. So on the site, the current site that we're standing on right now, you see in green there, that's where the additions are. Again, this site is probably, especially when it comes to Woodview, this is one of your worst sites when it comes to safety and site circulation and traffic. So as part of this project, we're creating a whole new parking area and drop-off area out to the west of Woodview. It's labeled as main entry here, but the main entry would be just during the morning and the afternoon for student drop-off and parent drop-off. During the day, your main entry still would remain here, and that parking that's along here still will be there for visitors and for staff. The major difference that you see here is this kind of new circulation area here in between the buildings. Now, currently, again, that's labeled as bus drop-off. The thought is they come off of 9th Avenue, circulate in, drop off at both schools, and circulate back out. It's been noted in committee, and this is one of the things that Kapoor is looking at, is would this one be better flip-flop too? Would it be better to have buses out here and actually the police recommended out on Hickory Street and then do the parents back here, or would it be better the way it's shown right now? What Mark mentioned, and which I'll just kind of reinforce here, it essentially is, with the exception of maybe a turn lane or something like that, it's essentially kind of the same scope. It's just flip-flopping the function. So as we look at this, that's why you mentioned that we feel very comfortable with being able to do whatever Kapoor comes out with within the budget and within the capacity of the current referendum. And actually, Kapoor confirmed that with the school district before they even started their part of the study. So we didn't talk about what's happening in this facility right here for John Long. There are things that are happening here. All of that is concerned with infrastructure upgrades and accessibility upgrades. So for instance, I believe right out here, some of these, a large share of the classroom doors are not accessible because they're recessed too far into an alcove. Those kind of things are going to be addressed. Doorknobs, other accessibility issues, door operators, those kind of things will all be addressed as part of this. And then there's going to be some things like with lighting and electrical and HVAC that will be addressed in this facility too. A couple other things that aren't kind of covered in this presentation before I turn it over to Jeff. Within the budget, obviously, is a line item, and this is again on the website. You can go in and take a look at the detail. Included within that is a budget for demolishing Grafton Elementary, obviously. The plan is that we deconstruct that facility. We don't just, you know, throw it into a dumpster and take it away. If there's a use for materials or if there's things that are salvageable from that facility, that will be done as part of this process. And then what's also not shown is there's a budget to do the work at the district facility or district offices, I should say. That includes infrastructure, electrical, HVAC things, and also ADA upgrades there. And then because Jamie's facilities and the district maintenance facilities are in GES, there's a budget of about $500,000 to construct a new, basically it's a I don't want to say a pole building, but it's a lower cost facility that'll be located adjacent to the high school to serve things like storage of lawnmowers, storage of district materials, maintenance shops, those kind of things. So there is a budget in there for that. And the very last thing I'll talk about, again, which isn't up there, is how what's the schedule for all this to happen? Obviously, when the referendum passes in April, if everything goes well, design is going to start right away. And actually, design, if you look back there, design has already started. That's the reality. But the intent is that all the design will be completed by the end of this summer. And bidding will happen in the August to September time frame. That means that construction at the elementary schools, Kennedy and Woodview, actually would start this year yet, getting in the ground before the snow flies, as well as some work happening at the high school. Now, obviously, we have to complete those additions at Woodview and Kennedy before we can take GES down. So the intention is that by August of 2018, next year, all the renovations and additions at those schools will be done, so we can start deconstruction. You can make the move in the fall of 2018 to reallocate students from GES and students and staff from GES over to the other facilities, and then start taking that facility down. What would happen, everything here at John Long would most likely take place the summer of this year yet. That's the summer of next year. And as I mentioned, the high school construction will take place over kind of multiple phases. With all this construction, we're really trying to do any sort of remodelings and renovations during the summer to impact students as least as we can, and let school function without us getting in the way. The very last things that'll happen, obviously, is the reclamation of the site where GES is, and then any of the work that needs to be done for the district office and that little classroom addition that was shown there, that little two-story classroom addition. But that kind of wraps it up. All in, we're projecting that this is all complete by December of next year. With that, I'll let Jeff.
So, you know, one of the issues is with the closing of an elementary school, there obviously is a concern, well, will elementary class sizes go up? What will that do with that? We're going from three schools to two schools. Well, are they looking to cut different programs? And that's not the goal at all. The board has made that clear. The class sizes will not increase. This doesn't mean we're going to have elementary classes of 28. The max we have right now is 25 at our various levels, and that's in fourth grade that we have that now. And so at the younger levels, they're lower than that. So it isn't to do that or to take away educational opportunities. There's a cost savings of closing the school of the elementary principal, of going from three to two, which will have a long-term savings every year. Jamie and Topher, whom I'm about to introduce, they had someone come in to do an energy study the other day of taking a tour of our buildings and saying, if we do these infrastructure upgrades, what will be the savings that we would have on a yearly basis with that as well? And so we're looking to get that back in that first week in March to see what those savings would be. So the goal of moving to four is to really allow us to be long-term fiscally able to maintain our buildings and attract and retain high-quality staff for that. But the board is going to be sensitive to both the families and the staff. We had a presentation this afternoon with staff today and at GES. I mean, that's a nervous thing. I'm in one building, and now where am I going to be in 2 years? And I like my colleagues, and I like who I work with, and who will I work with in the future? Like, that makes you nervous, and parents are in that same boat. So we know as I said to them, it's an emotional question that we're giving a logical answer to. And those don't always mesh well together, but that's what the committee has come together on, and what the board has approved to move forward with that. So it does have less building maintenance, ministry salaries. We aren't going to be having to budget for five boilers, five air conditioning units, five roofs, all those types of things that would go with that for the long-term maintenance that would go with that. I'm going to introduce Topher Adams, who's our business manager, and he'll walk us through the tax impact of the referendum.
All right. See if we have
hello.
All right, thank you for being here tonight. We are just about to the end, and then we can take your questions. I'm going to go through a financing plan put together by our financial advisor Baird. In the event of a successful referendum, we would the district would raise $39.93 million through two debt issues. One in 2017, later this year, for $29.93 million. And another one in 2018 for $10 million. Both of these debt issues would be paid off over a 20-year period. Now, Baird is using an estimate of a 4.5% interest rate on the first issue and a 4% interest rate on the second issue. Now, currently, Interest rates are lower than that, but Baird has built in a cushion in the event that interest rates increase between now and when we actually issue the debt. And then on this slide, I've also included information on what the interest payments would be over the 20-year period, just like a mortgage would have interest payments, as well as the estimated loss of state aid that would come with increasing debt payments. Now, in this slide, we see the tax impact per $1,000 of property. On both our current debt, which is in blue, as well as financing an additional $39.93 million of new debt in green. And I want to point out that that impact in green does include principal, interest, as well as the impact of a loss of state aid. Now, as you can see, with our current debt in blue, we have a drop in our current debt payments in 2018, and our current debt is completely paid off in 2021. So there will be no more payments on our current debt in 2022. So that drop in debt payments in 2018 would reduce the mill rate 72 cents in 2018. New debt would increase, would add $1.38 for a net increase of 66 cents in 2018 on property per $1,000 of property. Now, what does that mean for our property tax bill? This chart shows that impact on the 2018 property tax bill. For example, the property tax on a $100,000 home would decrease $72 because of the drop in current debt payments. New debt would add $138 to that property tax bill for a net increase on that annual property tax bill of $66. This would basically be an additional $5.50 on that monthly mortgage payment. And with that, questions?
You don't have to give your name, but if you wouldn't mind speaking into it, because we're taping it, I'll move it so you don't have to get seen. You don't have to give your name or your address or anything. But then they can hear it. That's what they're having to speak into the mic, even though it's a small enough number that we probably could just talk to you.
I guess my question is, do the changes take into account either the growth or the decrease in families moving into the area? Like, how do you think that these changes will affect the homes? Do you feel that there's going to be an influx of families or not, and how that kind of comes into play?
Yeah, so that was one of the things that the committee looked at, was what were the amount of home permits that have been, building permits that have been issued, both in the village and in the town, and concluded that it's really being steady, but it isn't seeing an increase, an uptick. Other communities around us have passed referendums now. So Port Washington, Germantown, Mequon a year ago have seen that. And so we don't know if the referendum is going to result in more students coming to us. But what we're hoping to do is to say we're going to be able to provide a dynamic future for our students. So as we look at our enrollment at the elementary school, we believe even though there's two bubble classes that are down there now, there's also like the opposite of that at each level. It's almost like one year there's 145 kids in fourth grade, in fifth grade there's 126, in third grade right behind that 145 there's 114. So we believe that as we looked at, and that was one of the things that the committee wrestled with, was should we build more elementary classrooms that would just be sitting there just in case people, in case we had a big influx of people. And it was to build a space, it's a couple $100,000 for each classroom. And so we didn't see that as being a wise fiscal use of taxpayer dollars, which is why we didn't add extra space that would just be sitting there waiting for people to come in. But as Jody says, as they're designing it, we're designing it so that it will be fiscally able for us to be able to do that in the future if a rapid expansion was able to occur. But at all those other levels, there's enough room that we have room for students to come in for our current students. And then we would look at limiting the number of students from open enrollment that are coming in. Right now, we sort of supplement, if there's only 20 kids in a class, if you add two kids, then that's you're basically not paying more for a teacher, but you're adding more revenue into paying for the facility. But if you add five people and now I got to pay for another teacher, well, now you're losing money. And so we'd be watching that as well. And we've done that this year for certain classes that we closed off because they're getting to that capacity, and we don't want to go over that. We want to take care of our current students. But those are good, great question. That's one of the things that the committee really struggled with, is setting that up. And it really came down to, like, what are the needs? Because I think when we had this original plan early on was like $47 million. And then we had listening sessions in November. And then some of the feedback we received there was, you know, that's still too high. We'd had it, at that point, it was $44,977. So then we had listening sessions in November that were in the auditorium. The committee came back and brought it down to $42,580. And then the final thing that was moved forward to the board was at 41,243. And so then they made hard choices. For example, one of the plans was that there was going to be a new entrance at Woodview, and that was going to cost an extra 300 or 400 or 350 or something like that. It was a high number, and the board said, no, let's remodel where we are there to save that money. So they really took a hard look, which really got us to 39.93. So it was almost like we kept listening to the community, and the listening sessions, I think that Paul and anyone, help me. Was it Mark and Clayton, right? Was it three of you? I wasn't here, but I think it was Clayton and Paul and Mark that was one of the concerns of the last referendum was price. So where are we at with price? So the board and the committee really took a hard look at that. But we didn't focus just on price, because we focused on the needs, but making sure that the needs that we had were something that we were able to articulate. The beginning use of Fund 46, which you've heard maybe some things about, where we've created a fund that just 2 years ago the state allowed to start getting ready for long-range planning. Our goal is by June of 2021, to have $1 million in that, which will pay for long-term capital improvements. And it isn't for a rainy day. There's certain things that we haven't put in the referendum that will be, that have a lifespan longer of 5 years, that we'll immediately be addressing at that point. We also have $250,000 in Fund 41 that we're addressing certain things as well that aren't gonna have a 20-year lifespan. We've tried to make sure that everything's in the referendum will last 20 years. So there isn't technology, computers in there, things like that. There are things that will last 20 years and other things that we're using out of our budget to fund for that.
How much of the playground will be gone for Woodview?
How much of the playground will be gone for Woodview? I'll help you. Yep. Good question. It takes out 50 feet to the east. If I can go back right there, right? Yeah, so the paved play area. So it'll take out some of this here is what it would take out there. So 50 feet. So I think that's probably where kids are checking in the morning is about where that is now. That's about, I think, 50 feet, about right about that area there.
Are they going to add air conditioning at Woodview?
Are they going to add air conditioning at Woodview? Yes, that was one of the things that the board discussed, as that was one of the potential cuts or that would occur, because as the new construction was coming in, why don't I let you talk about this, actually?
That was one of the options that the board was allowed to consider, but the reality is as we're putting in air conditioning and new HVAC units for these additions, it makes sense for us to go back and air condition the rest of the facility as opposed to wait and do it at some time in the future. There was a lot of discussion about this, because there were comments that we don't need air conditioning, you know, it's, you know, they're out by the time that you need air conditioning. The reality is the environment that the kids are learning in actually does make a difference. So if they're too hot, they're not focusing. So for those times that you do need to be running the air conditioning, you will now have that option.
And that's also at Kennedy as well. So both Woodview and Kennedy would have air conditioning. Other questions? I won't make you get up. I'll repeat it for you. Yeah.
So I'm all for voting yes on all this, but just in case
mentioned, biomed, tech ed, stuff like that, so that those can benefit the students and continue to grow.
So the question is, what's the backup plan if the referendum doesn't pass in April? And this we've heard probably at almost every one of our listening sessions with staff as well. Mark did a nice job answering it today.
Sure, yeah. I mean, truly, we don't have a concrete backup plan. I was just elected in April of last year and jumped right in because as soon as I got on, obviously the April referendum last year failed. And Paul and Clayton and I hit the ground running, and we were out in the community gathering input about last year's referendum and what was wrong and why didn't it pass, what were the concerns. So, you know, I think we'd have to take a look again at what's there. We've done a lot of work to gather those needs and come up with a solution, and that facilities committee that we had was a good, diverse group. We were very deliberate about who we selected to be on there. They actually applied. We evaluated all those people. We had people that we knew were in support of last year's referendum. We knew there were people that were not in favor of it. We had people who were good in construction and financial, real estate. We had a good diverse group. And so we gathered some good information. I think if it doesn't pass, we're gonna have a lot of homework done that we can relook at this. Are there gonna be concessions? You bet. Because like you talk about the high school, you know, I think those might be things that wouldn't be included. Because I think GES is kind of the linchpin of this whole thing, and we'd have to address that. Well, okay, now you've got two sections of classes or students at each grade. Where are they going? We have to have a place for them. So do we have a concrete plan? No. I think we've got a lot of information that could feed into another plan pretty quick.
Yeah, so the question is has that been communicated that it will impact students as they move forward? And in all of our presentations, we're emphasizing that. Like, I mean, you're seeing it was $47.5 million last April. The committee came through, and one of the issues was costs. So now it's down to 39.93. You know, they're saying that Hoffman is saying that costs have also risen by 7 to 10%. He's talking about, what kind of wood did you say? Engineered wood being up 12% next month because of various things. And so supply and demand is going up. Supply, you know, demand's going up, and supply is maybe not is lagging. So cost is going up. So we know that our $39.93 million isn't getting what $39.93 million would have got last April. It's getting 7 to 10% less. So if people were to say, well, and you're never going to have a referendum that is voted down, and then you're going to come, well, maybe not never, but I don't see our board having a referendum get voted down and then coming back for more money. And if GES is the linchpin, then that's what's going to have to address. So then the science facilities are going to be the way they are. You're not going to have the extra gym, like all those pieces, which will affect, as people look at our district as a viable district with other great options around them, why would we be the top choice for them? And part of our mission is to prepare learners for a dynamic tomorrow. So, you know, you think about building, and a lot of times we think about like it's the nuts and bolts of a building, but really we're talking about building kids' lives. We're trying to provide them opportunities. If 3 years ago we didn't know that we were going to Project Lead the Way, and there's 102 kids in there, now there's 180 kids in there. Like, what's that going to be like 10 years from now? There's going to be something else that's going to come along. Right, their careers, well, they say half the careers that are out there aren't even created yet by the time for kids that are starting school in the kindergarten level. Like, we're not preparing kids for a career. We're preparing kids to be able to be flexible, so that they can learn on the go and they can collaborate, that they're problem solvers and those types of things. And there's definitely curriculum that helps students be that way. And we need classroom settings, and that's why we're designing spaces. You know, this is a great room because there aren't a lot of walls. There aren't pillars. There aren't walls in here. You go to the high school and their IMC. It's like, well, yeah, I have to look around the pillar. I mean, so things were designed 40, 50 years ago differently than they are now, and we're trying to be aware of that as we're looking at the designation of various things. Even the little things like Woodview, you know, or at Kennedy where we have a computer lab right now, we need to design that so that 5, 10, even less years when we don't have computer labs – that can be used as something, and it's not we're sitting there like, oh, well, why'd we do that? You know, and so being aware of the changes that are occurring as we move through that. So that's definitely something that we're talking about. I mean, the facility needs are what they are. And that's why there isn't a plan B, because we're trying to use all of our energy to talk about this is the best, this meets our facility needs and will prepare students for a dynamic tomorrow. Any other questions? Okay, well, it's almost an hour, so we appreciate all of you coming. As Jody had said, all of our information is on our website. So if you go to our website, and if you have any questions about anything, or if someone has questions and you want to refer them to somewhere, this is a great place to go, because we have a lot of our information that's up there. So facilities referendum. There's referendum presentation schedule, so the other things that are going on, facility plans, if you want to look at that, proposed project phasing, Jody talked a little about that, the budget summary, it breaks down by each building and each line item in each building, so you can see where money is being spent and the cost that goes with that, who was on the facilities advisory committee, district needs assessments, if you're like, what's the Sigma group study that they're talking about, what's that, what are some of those pieces, that's all in there, maintenance projects that have been addressed, enrollment study, community survey results that were done by school perceptions before last year's April 1, and then school parent presentation. So there's a ton of information on there. We keep adding things to it, so we're by next week we're hoping to have an FAQ, so frequently asked questions that will be on here that people can refer to as well. Your handout that you see tonight, we just finalized that yesterday, so that's going to be also going on here. So if people are looking for something, please refer them to this. Or if you see something, you're like, why don't you have this up there? At the bottom of that is my email. It's my phone number. If you feel more comfortable reaching out to a principal or to a board member, obviously feel free to do that. But we really want to make sure that we're getting it out as much as possible. You know, if you look at the presentation schedule, we're in each of our buildings. We're at the village board making a presentation. We're at the town board making a presentation. We're at the senior center making a presentation. We're going to Lions. We're going to Rotary. We're doing all the things that we can. If you walk into Collectivo or Starbucks or Pick and Save or Sendix now tonight or even tomorrow, you're going to see posters that are up of our facilities schedule, the referendum presentations. So we have those up as posters in the community as well. So getting people to be just aware of the process and be informed on April 4th. But we appreciate you coming tonight, and we look forward to partnering with you the rest of the year. Yeah.
Are all the presentations the same? They are.
Nope, they may differ a little based on questions that people are asking. We may add something to it. So like when Jody's like, you know, well, we don't have it in the presentation, but everyone's asking about the phasing, and we just gotten that from him last week, so we have it up there now. So, you know, it'll change a little, but the everything else, the boards are basically going to be the same, the design piece, all that stuff's going to be the same. And we're recording them, so they also are live. So if someone says, well, I don't have time, they can watch it at their leisure as well. Okay, excellent. Thank you, everyone. Have a great night.